Hello, everyone. This is Direwolf 20, and welcome to episode 52 of Direwolf 20's Let's Play series. I have been busy. And by busy, I mean busy. Let's make 100 pieces of glass, please. And then I can get back to making a computer-controlled tablet thingy. So, I think I ended up last episode telling you guys that I would be doing some work, writing a little bit of a computercraft program so that I could control my frame quarry with computercraft. I'm here to tell you, mission accomplished. To a point. And I'm going to get into the details of that in just a bit. But for the most part, it's working, and we are going to set that up this episode. And I'm hopefully going to get to show you guys some really cool stuff that I made. So I think it's neat, and I will let you guys be the deciders of that. So you can go ahead and leave some comments at the end of this video after you check it out, and tell me if you think it's a really cool build, or if you think it was like a little bit silly to go over engineering like I did. It's probably a little over-engineered, but let's be honest, it's what Direwolf does. Actually, there's one or two more things I'm going to want to grab here. Why don't I get the following items? I don't think we've made one of these yet, so I'm going to make it on camera. An angel block. Dun-dun-dun-dun! These guys are awesome and very useful for building things in the sky. We're also going to want a wireless modem. Or probably six. And we're going to put one of those guys, by the way, on our advanced pocket computer. There's a crafting recipe here somewhere. How do I do this? Oh, the modem goes on top. See, I tried every permutation, but there we go. So now we've got an advanced wireless pocket computer. What does that do? Well, I'll show you in a minute. So before we do anything, I'm going to get up here in the sky and I'm going to place down an angel block. What's cool is you can place an angel block not on other blocks. So you don't have to actually have another angel block or another block nearby to place it. That's why I wanted to snag one of those. And from here, we are going to build ourselves a wireless. Oh, by the way, it has like no breaking damage, so you can just click it and it always automatically goes right back into your inventory. So even from a distance, watch, boom, right in my inventory. Love angel blocks. They're super useful. I'm going to make, unlike glass blocks, which are the opposite of useful. There we go. I'm going to make a GPS tower. So this is one of the parts of the build that you guys are going to have to do if you want to replicate my build. So computers are cool in that they can track their coordinates in the world using a GPS tower like the one I just built. Basically, all that has to happen is in order for any computer or tablet in the world to get its XYZ position, that XYZ position, you need to have four computers somewhere nearby that can send their coordinates. So to configure this, first we have to tell this computer what his coordinates are. So it's really easy to do. Any program that you write in ComputerCraft that is named startup will automatically run when the computer starts up. And we're going to run the GPS program. And we're going to tell it to be a host. And then we're going to tell it its X, okay, its Y, and its Z position. Now remember, the Y position here is 100 of your feet. So the actual Y position of this computer is probably 99, right? So if my feet are on position 100, then my computer is on position 99. Cool. And then we tell it the Z position. Oh, and by the way, you need to put these all in quotes, so don't forget that either. Okay, and then 389. And I usually just round down, so 389, 100, 20, 51. That's probably a good way to go. You know, no sense in doing it anywhere. Try and stand about on the center of the block and then round down. Cool? So now when we restart the computer, no wireless modems found. So an important part of that is installing a wireless modem somewhere. Any side of the computer will do. It doesn't matter which side you put it on, and boom. Opening channel, modem on right. Position is 2051, 99, 389. Perfect. I'm going to go do this for the other three computers that are part of this GPS tower. All right, so now all four computers know their GPS position, right? And that's ideal. So these guys are all covered, Y102 and everything else. Now, if we come down here, did I put a modem on this thing yet? No, I didn't. Okay, so I'm gonna need one more modem at the end of the day. I'm actually going to want, yeah, it should be fine. That should be cool. If we do something like GPS locate, it should be able to tell me the XYZ position of this computer. Let's see if it's correct. 2042, 64, 390. Remember, the computer is one block below my feet, so it's 64 Y level, and all the other information is correct. Awesome. So now we have a way to detect, given a computer, its position in the world. Very cool. I'm gonna go make one more wireless modem and come back because we have the next step to do. So the next thing I'm gonna do is place a wireless modem and a computer right on this little frame contraption that I've got. And if I GPS locate this, now we can find the position of the computer that's on the frame. So now we know where the frame is at all times, right? And every time we want the frame to move, we'll know whether or not it moved because we can check after we tell the frame to move if the computer is in a new position. And that is one of the core functionalities of the computer craft program I wrote. So there's a couple more pieces of information we need. We need the ID of the computer that's on the frame, and that's apparently 6. And we need the ID of the computer that's on here. Cool. We should also label them. So we'll call this main computer, and we should label this guy frame computer. Okay? And what this does is anytime you break and pick up the computer, it'll remember it so it won't lose its programs. If you don't label it and you break it, anything that you've done on the computer is lost. So that's a bad thing. Not necessarily lost. If you're in single player, it's in your world saves folder. And if you're on a server, it's on the server's world saves folder. So technically not lost, but you won't have access to it anymore unless you have access to the world save, which is either on the server or on your computer. So now let's put some programs on here. So I've put two programs in this computer. The first one is startup, and all that does, if we type startup correctly, is run the await signal program. The await signal program, his main job, and I'm not going to go through the code for you guys, but I will do a separate video explaining it. His main job is to wait for somebody to ask him what his position is and send back the XYZ coordinates. So that's all he does. All I need to do now is send him a question, "Hey, where are you?" from another computer, and we'll be able to find out where he is. The second computer is this one. This is also important. Let's get this one configured. So this one is also configured with a startup program, and his job is to run the main program. Now, the main program, his job is to do a lot of things, and I'm not gonna go through all the code like I said, but he will be able to move the frame by sending redstone signals to these guys back here. Cool. Now I've actually got one or two more redstone things to set up, so we'll set that up in a minute. But before we do that, there's one more thing I need to do, and that is get my pocket computer out. Dun 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 dun. What ID are you? You are ID 1. Label set pocket. Cool. And there's one other thing I need to change in here. There should really only be one thing that when you guys download this world, if you download the world, you don't have to change it, but if you use the code for something yourselves, you will have to change it. And that is the frame's computer ID, which I believe was 6. Cool. Pretty sure this guy was 6. Yes. All right, let me get my pocket computer set up. So the pocket computer has a pretty complicated program as well. We need to tell him the main computer ID, which is 0, remember, and the frame computer ID, which is 6. And let's see if there's anything else I have to do to get the frame program working. Dun 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 dun. Oh yeah, so you want to reboot the main computer before you do this. And now we'll try the frame program. Hey, there we go. Cool. So I should be able to click this button that says refresh frame coordinates and find out the coordinates of the frame. 2054, 71, 365. 2054, 71, 365. Look at that. Perfect. And there's a couple other things we can do. But before I can use all of these functions, we are going to need to do one more configuration piece, which really isn't too hard. And that is going to be done in just a minute. Let me go back and craft a couple things. Luckily, I taught my AE system how to make a wireless transmitter and receiver, so it's really easy to do. Hooray! Let's head back to the frame and install it. So these guys already were controlling the up, down, forward, and backward functions with wireless receivers. There's one more that we're going to want to do here, and we'll call this frequency 7. So we'll hit that guy. Frequency 7. And we will call this item send. So what this thing is going to do, ready for this? check it out. We're going to put this here. We're going to make sure that you are configured on the west face, I think it was, on purple. Cool. This is going to send the items back to the base. Remember, we configured this last episode. So you are going to be a wireless receiver on frequency 7 for item send. And you can see this guy is already connected up there. And if we check on the up, you can see it's already set to in and out. Cool. So now, because that's configured, I should be able to open up this guy and run frame. And if everything's set up right, watch this. I should be able to click the send items button. Look at that. The drives went and came back. How cool is that, huh? Ta-da! Now, it might flip back and forth real quick, depending on how fast it goes back in there, but eventually they'll land back in the thing. It's no big deal. We can also control some other cool stuff. So we can get the frame coordinates by clicking on that, okay? And then we can hit the down button. Watch. Dun-dun-dun! And it moved. And we can hit down again. So I'll be totally honest, having the up, down, left, right button was mostly for fun, just so I could have, like, a remote control for my frame query. Is this really necessary and is this how you're gonna run this thing? Probably not. But you can hit up and it'll go up. And notice that the button stays green until it's done moving. That's an important thing that I made sure was in there. The backward button moves the frame backwards and the forward button moves the frame forward. Pretty cool, right? Now there's two other buttons here, bedrock and sea level. What bedrock does is it will send this thing all the way down to bedrock. And what sea level does is it'll send it back up to sea level, which I defined as around Y level 75. We'll see. So let's refresh the coordinates. I considered having this thing auto-refresh the coordinates, but just trust me, it was too much of a hassle. So if somebody else wants to change it so that it does that and, you know, is not as much of a hassle, be my guest. But for now, you have to hit refresh coordinates to update it. Because what was happening is while the frame was moving, if it was trying to refresh the coordinates, like the computer is kind of not there while the frame's moving. You don't want to try and refresh the coordinates while the frame's moving, so trust me, just bleh. Anyway, let's send it to sea level. Boom. What it's going to do is it's going to keep moving upwards until the computer gets to the right point. By the way, you can click refresh coordinates, and it'll wait for the frame to be in a stable position so it can actually get the coordinates. So there we go. You can see that it refreshed there. Nice. And it's moving it up and moving it up. We'll refresh it again. You'll see it hit 75. That's cool. So we've hit Y level 75, that's what I call sea level. Now if I want to send it to bedrock, I can do that. But there's a couple other buttons here. First off, let's send it to bedrock, and you'll see that it just starts moving downwards. But let's say it was in the middle of moving down to bedrock, and I wanted it to stop in its tracks. Not a problem, click the stop button. Boom. Notice the bedrock thing turned off and it stopped moving. And the same for sea level. I can let it start going up to sea level here, and let's see, come on, there we go. And if I hit stop, boom, it stops. Nice, right? Let me sleep through the night, and then we'll check out some other cool things it can do. So like I said, I'm not really going to go through all the code here, but I will probably try and do this in a separate video for you guys who are really interested in how it works. Now, if I wanted to, I could just send it to bedrock, but you know what I'm probably going to want to do is not have too much manual control over this. So I added two other buttons here. One of them is called cycle. What cycle does is it basically sends it to bedrock, then brings it back up to sea level, and then tells it to move forward 8 blocks, which is exactly how wide this thing is. So when we run the cycle command, it'll start, and it'll also highlight the button of the function that it's currently on. So currently, it's running towards bedrock. Cool. And I think cycle even has the send items command in there at some point, right? So if I wanted to do that, I could. Nifty, right? So it's on its way to bedrock. Oh yeah. So let's let this thing run for a few minutes and then we'll be right back. All right guys, so as you can see, we are approaching bedrock and the program is still telling us that we're, you know, running the bedrock function. We can refresh our coordinates, see that we're down near Y level 14. Hopefully none of these things that are getting in our way here, like this lava, is going to be a nuisance for us, but we'll find out in a minute. And if we watch, once we hit right close to bedrock, which we're about 5 seconds from, we should see some cool stuff happen. And watch the computer program too when it gets close to bedrock. Can you tell I'm a little bit proud of this thing? So now it's heading back up to sea level. Cool, and it's on its way back up. When it gets up there, by the way, I think is when it runs the send items command. I kind of forget. All the items should be collected. Yep, see, there they all are. You have to catch it really quick before it moves again. But you'll notice that it does a pretty good job of moving pretty steadily. What it actually does is it sends a command to the computer telling it to move, and then it checks to see if it moves, and it keeps sending like the move command until it's done. So you'll notice that it's blinking pretty quickly there, but it's going to make sure that it actually moved before it stops. That was the best way to get it to really, you know, move quickly. Cool. So you can see that we're almost back up to sea level here, and if we refresh the coordinates, we're getting close, Y level 63. And again, it's this main computer with the wireless signals that's doing all the work. The frame, or the pocket program here, is sending messages to the computer telling it what to do. And then really all that computer does is get the GPS coordinates of the frame, which helps to, number one, display them on the pocket computer. But it's also important because that guy does checks to say, hey, did your XYZ position change? And if it did, I know for a fact that the movement was successful. That's basically how it works. Like I said, we'll have a separate video to explain this. So let's keep an eye on this thing. Now that we're getting pretty close to Y level 75, there it goes. So we should see send items running, and then the cycle is going to run forward 8 blocks. Now I might want to bump this up above 75 because you'll see that if we, you know, allow this thing to continue, we'll probably run into a cliff face at some point, and I haven't written any logic around that. So there's nothing that's going to say, hey, if you get stuck on a cliff face, try and go up and over it or something. It's something that I could write eventually. Another option, of course, is to put some annihilation planes on the front here. But we would have to have them up as high as that block, probably, if we wanted to be accurate about it. I could probably change some of this to make it more of a flat design so that we don't need as many annihilation planes. I'm going to consider it. We shall see what happens. But we'll see. Maybe, maybe. So for now, the cycle is complete. The only other function here, and what happened to my frame computer? I had it around here somewhere. I must have dropped it. I think I hit Q by mistake. There it is. The only other thing that we need to know about is the auto mode. So auto mode just runs the cycle function over and over. So when I turn on auto mode, boom, it's going to enable cycle, and it's going to run that cycle function over and over. So cycle does it once, right? Go down, come back up, move forward 8, I'm done. Auto mode just runs cycle over and over and over again until I say stop. And when I say stop, it should stop. So it'll send items and then be done. Nice. All right, guys, so for now, I'm going to tell this thing to do another cycle and hopefully leave it here and come back. But actually, before we do that, let's stop it. Everybody stop. There we go. Done. Let's go get ourselves a couple of items that it's going to be kind of necessary for this thing to keep working. Let's pop upstairs. There's two of the same item that we're going to need to use. Any guesses as to what it is? Dun dun dun, chunk loaders, that's right, we will need to have chunk loaders. So let's see, 1, 2, and 1, 2. The reason we need chunk loaders is really pretty simple. We need to keep the main computer program and the GPS tower running at pretty much all times. So let's do that. If we were to check this out, I'll just pop this guy right here, that should be fine. So that should be keeping everything loaded. And if you want, we can show lasers here to make sure I shouldn't have to extend this any further than it already is. Yeah, see, the GPS tower will be loaded at all times because they're going to need to respond to computer requests, and the main program will be loaded as well. Now, as for this guy, we should probably put this guy down right here. So we'll show lasers on him, and he's just going to be responsible for keeping the frame itself loaded. So that's both the computer and the frame so that it can move. So we can hide lasers. Now there's only one other thing I want to mention to you guys. By default, in ComputerCraft, wireless modems have kind of a short range. At sea level, they're about 64 blocks. So the problem I was running into while building this program was once this frame query, which we're right now right around Y level 65, 64, once it got down to like, you know, Y level 20-ish around here, it was 64 blocks away from that computer, and the computer stopped responding to requests. And that was very disappointing for Direwolf because I had a lot of fun writing this program. So there's a config option in Computercraft. I actually asked the guys at FTB to make it the default in the next version of the Direwolf 20 pack, which will be 1.04. So when you get 1.04 of the pack, this config setting will already be changed. But I just basically bumped up the range of wireless modems. And then I was talking to Dan 200, the author of Computercraft, about it, and he said he's considering adding a new modem type that has like kind of an infinite range and would maybe even work across dimensions. I don't know if that's definitely going in yet, so don't count on that. But it would be cool if it did. All right, so now that we got this thing running, we can go ahead and hit cycle again, and he's going to run through an entire cycle. We're going to let that run and come back and check on him in just a little bit. So now I can safely leave the area and not worry about the chunks unloading, and we are in good shape. All right, so the next thing that we're running into something of an issue of is these 4K ME storage cells. So let's make a pattern about how to make them. And I'm going to throw them in one of our molecular assembler interfaces. It probably doesn't matter which one. That'll do. So now the AE system knows how to make 4K cells, right? So let's see if we can come up with a way to automatically craft 4K ME storage cells when necessary. So you'll notice that right now we've got, close to running out of space here. So these guys are starting to get filled up with items, and this one's the only empty ME4K cell. If I take that out of there, we can still put items in there, but we're really running low on space in our AE system. And that is going to be a problem for us. So let's see what we can come up with for the purposes of automating this a little bit. I think it might be a smart thing to do. So let's check it out. All right, guys, so I've been looking at my AE system for a little bit here, and it looks like it's time to expand it yet again. And in order to do that, I need to find a good place to call home. Now, kind of everything that's in this immediate area clearly is all designed around the AE system, right? So this is all Applied Energistics related stuff. And this room would be a great spot for some more AE stuff, but I built this crazy contraption in here with Ender Lily seeds and Ender Lilies. I could break it all up, or I could do something a little bit more fun to move it. I think more fun is the answer here, right? Clearly, I hope. So let's take a blood shard, a weak one, and combine it with an enhanced teleposition focus, which you get by taking the existing teleposition we focus we had before, bumping it up in the altar with 10,000 LP to get the enhanced version. We add that together, and now we've got the reinforced teleposition focus. This guy is cool. Let's right-click to bind them to Direwolf 20, and what this thing does is the first tier version moves a 1x1 area, the second tier version moves a 3x3 area, this is the third tier version that moves a 5x5 area. So, hey, this room's 5x5. Perfect. Let's dig under the ground. So what I'm gonna say is I'm just gonna go ahead and move this thing, because he's not going to get captured anyway. And we'll just relocate this thing somewhere. Where is it going? I don't know. I haven't figured that much out yet. Hopefully not too far. All right, so that should do. So I think all I have to do is plop this guy right there, bind the teleposition focus to its location, and find a new place to call this thing home. Let's go. I've got a plan. We put this guy in here and give him a redstone signal. Everybody stand back. Hello, how's it going? Well, that mostly worked. You guys seem to want to move back to your original positions, though. That's all right, I don't blame you. I didn't think they would clearly, realize that they belong somewhere else now, but that's all right. They're gonna come with me, courtesy of the Gallimancer's Bell. Come back here, you guys. Thanks, you're with me. So not terrible. Most of the things moved all right. Did it not catch? 1, 2, 3. It should have brought the Ender Lily seeds with me, but if not, not the end of the world. We've got more. It might have left them back here. Yeah, it did. Okay, that's fine. Did I get 9 of them? I did. Cool. So I'm gonna find a new place to call these guys home. For the time being, though, I'm just going to leave it out here so that, you know, and I'll move it later. Let's just put it that way. Yeah. You know what? I'm going to leave the golems in there, too. Basically, everything that the system represents, right? One thing we should do, just to be smart about this, remember, without a redstone signal, this thing will continuously run. We probably don't want that. So we should make sure that we apply that redstone signal there to save us on the LP drain that would otherwise be happening. All right. Now that we've got this room freed up, I think it's a good place for our AE storage room. This is where I'm going to have all my AE storage stuff, in theory. So let's get, for now, just a bit of smooth stone. Not glowstone, direwolf. And let's do it up. And for now, I'll keep it the same size and shape that it is, but I may at some point in the future decide I need more space in this area, and we'll go from there. So first things first, let's get some cabling in here. And I prepared myself some dense cable just for this purpose. And I should have some smart cable in here as well, but I'm probably going to need more. So let's request 20. Yes, I can get that many. Awesome. So go ahead and craft that for me, AE system. And while that's going, where's my wireless AE system access thing? There it is. Sweet. Actually, no, that's where I want it to be. So dense cable, I'm actually going to upgrade this output here to be dense cabling. So we're going to remove these guys. This stuff's going to pop off. That's fine. We're going to run this down here, and I'll probably... That's okay. So yeah, that'll connect into the dense cable. We're using, you know, 7 channels or so over there. And then we're going to probably run another line right around here-ish. Okay, just getting my bearings. Aha, so that's where I am. Okay, cool. That'll do. So as a matter of fact, we're probably going to want to snag our smooth stone. And probably replace a couple lines here. So I'm just going to tap into this thing. We're going to put the dense cable here. Nah, this should be smart cable. These guys can be dense, so there you go. And then we'll have a line breaking off here. Do we have any regular cable? No, but I got more dense, so or some smart, so that will work. What I'm probably going to do, actually, make it extra fancy looking. There we go. So we should have no channels in use there yet, which is fine. It's what you would expect. And we'll fill this thing in. Cool. And do we have any facades handy for smooth stone? Not yet, but I'll get some in a little bit. For now, that looks good, right? I am actually going to need some facades. There is one. This guy, I think. There we go. Nice. So that is going to be where I'm going to move this thing. So for the time being, let's clean up our inventory a little bit, because we're going to need as much space as we can have in here. I don't need any of this. This will hang on to... The bell can go back in the bag. As well as you and you. That should do. Cool. Well, I'm up here. Let's make our facades. We want smooth stone surrounded by cable anchors, right? That should be enough to get us going. And I'm also going to want another disk drive. So do I have the stuff to make all of that? I'm going to need two engineering processors. Luckily, I should be able to just do this, and I'll get some. Ta-da! At some point, I will automate this system so that we always have a certain number of engineering processors and such available, like we did before. But for now, this will get us going. Okay? So, disk drive's ready. Let's get ready to move this thing. So what I have to do for the time being is take all our stuff out of the AE system and wrench this up. And you'll notice now our AE system is totally empty. No, there's nothing left. It's all gone. That's okay. Don't worry. For now, temporarily, you're connected there, and that should be good. And that shouldn't be using any extra channels. We're actually just saved ourselves a channel there. And for the time being, this will go here, and we'll light up this room a little bit. Cool. Okay. You can have your drives back. And that looks pretty sharp. And I believe that means that we will now once again have access to our stuff. Beautiful. I like it already. And I'll tidy up the walls in a bit. Next thing is covers. And I'm going to want, you know what? There you go. Sweet. I like it. Now, to go along with this, I'm going to want a little bit of extra something something. Let's get ourselves another interface or two. Let's say four of them. That should be doable. And from our interfaces, we're going to need a couple storage buses. I just want to make a bunch of pistons just to have them. Whatever could I be doing? We shall find out soon. Level emitter. That's the next thing I want. Awesome. Alright, that should do. And let's go downstairs again. And see if any of these are empty. What are you doing down here, Fallen Knight? I have no idea how he got here. Anyway, we're going to run some cabling like so. So we're going to place storage buses on the sides of our ME drives. And then we're going to have, well, probably something like this. Cool. These guys will connect in, they'll activate, and then we can cover up this wall a little bit. And there you go. The reason I wanted to do that is now I should be able to detect any storage buses in the network. So if we take, for example, a 4K drive, we'll see that we have several of them available. Let's see, are any of these empty or no? This one is. Oh no, wait, that's one that I have to craft. So let's do 4K. Can I empty this into the network? Let's see. If I can, it's a simple matter of doing it here. I just want to extract on brown. There we go, it emptied. So what I can do now is configure a level emitter to emit a redstone signal. He should activate in a moment. There he goes. When we have a 4K drive that's empty, we want at least one emit when levels are below or equal to limit. Okay. So I should make it zero, I guess. Well, let's make it one. Below or equal to one. Well, I'll make it 0. Are above or equal to. Yeah, I made a signal when there's 1 in there. Now I'll stick with below and 0. So if I put this in here, and I should probably put this at the bottom here so it's the last thing to go in. Mit levels when they are above or equal to 1. There we go. Cool. So you'll notice now that when we have a free drive in here, we're emitting a redstone signal. And when we don't have a completely empty drive in here, we don't emit a redstone signal. Nifty. All right, now there's only one more thing I want to do before we wrap up this episode, and you might have noticed that as a result of this configuration, when I look up 4K drives, I'm seeing them all on my network. Kind of don't want to do that. So what I'm going to do is knock this thing off here, and I'm going to put on this corner a quartz fiber. Quartz fiber acts like a cable when it comes to power, but not for data. Remember that you can have a small network of about eight devices, I should say, that doesn't need a controller, right? So if we take a look at this guy, what we should see is that this thing will still work. Drive in, lights on, drive out, lights off. But this quartz cable here is only giving this little subnetwork power. It's not transmitting the data that's contained within the subnetwork back to the main system. That means that if we look up 4K drives in here, there's nothing listed. This is a subnetwork that is not connected to the main network, and it's all by itself, just doing its own thing, which is monitoring these two drives here for at least one empty 4K storage cell. Now, as soon as we put some data in there, it's not going to be empty anymore, and we can probably demonstrate this by putting this thing up here and watch what happens when I put zombie flesh in the network. No, it has to be something new. Iron chestplate? Ta-da! Look at that. So as soon as we put that iron chestplate in the network, it went into the first drive available in this slot, which made this drive no longer empty, which turned off the light. So now we have an automatic way to detect when we're running low on free space in our ME drive. That's what we're going to use next episode to automate populating this drive with new empty cells. So now that we have an automated system that's in charge of mining for us, which, by the way, because I bumped up the range on it, works from our base. Hello, how's it going? By the way, do me a favor, run the cycle. Thank you, it's off to bedrock. And if we refresh coordinates, we should see it moving. Nice. So that thing's gonna mine, and we are gonna wrap up the episode. So for now, Direwolf20 signing off. Hope you enjoyed the episode. Next episode, we're gonna look into automating, putting new drives in this thing. And that's pretty much what I wanna look at. And then we'll come back and maybe do some more crazy stuff. For now, Direwolf20 signing off. Hope you enjoyed the episode. Like I said, take it easy.